mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods now, and we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
The greatest disruptor of all time is actually COVID-19. Because of limited mobility, people are also not being able to go to physical branches, etc. So it further accelerated the adoption of consumers of digital channels. We are now being able to provide the services needed by our citizens, by our consumers.
Mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods now, and we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow...
Michelle Long, it's 9 a.m. in Manila, 10 a.m. in Tokyo, and 12 noon in Sydney. The headlines, the Dow and the S&P 500 notching new record highs as Wall Street shrugs off fears about the Omicron variant. Asian shares, though, are set for a cautious start. Here at home, the PSE index takes a breather for the Rizal Day holiday after climbing back above the 7,300 level. Swarup Gupta of the Economist Intelligence Unit will be joining us later on the show for an outlook on Asian markets. President Rodrigo Duterte is set to sign the 5 trillion peso 2022 national budget today. And the Philippine government says rules are in place to ensure the protection of the environment as it lifts the ban on open pit mining. We speak with Rocky Dimakulangan of the Chamber of Mines of the Philippines about this development. We begin with the financial markets. The Dow and the S&P 500 reaching new record highs on Wednesday as investors shrugged off concerns about the fast-spreading Omicron variant. This extends the Dow's winning streak to 6 days, the longest since its seven-session run back in March, boosted by a jump in shares of U.S. retailers. The tech-heavy Nasdaq, meanwhile, bucking the trend, shedding 0.1% as tech stocks dip, following a rise in the 10-year Treasury yield. The final five trading days of the year and the first year of next year are seasonally strong for U.S. stocks, known for a Santa Claus rally. All the major indices are on track for their third straight year of stunning annual returns, boosted by historic fiscal and monetary stimulus. The S&P 500 looking at its strongest three-year performance since 1999.
What's unique now is the market is so flush with cash. So there, it's the, I say, the diversification. It's like funny, you see people in real estate, they want to go into the VC world. They think they missed the opportunity. You see people in the stock world say, hey, did I miss the opportunity? Real estate always survives on a hedge and a downturn. And look, also look at some of these returns these people made in the last year. These things changing, the people now look at the marketplace and say, I want to go on the other side. You know, the grass is greener.
Taking a look now at U.S. stock futures, all the major indices pointing to a lower open when trading resumes tonight, Manila time. Now, back here at home, Philippine President Rodrigo Duterte is set to sign the 5 trillion peso 2022 national budget today, Thursday. Duterte was supposed to sign the spending bill last Tuesday, but it was delayed, with Malacanang saying the measure was still under review.
With the signing of the 2022 national budget, maasahan po natin na in the remaining 6 months of the term of President Duterte, we will implement and fast-track lahat ng mga programa, proyekto, and activities na nakapaloob po sa 2022 national budget.
The 5 trillion peso 2022 national budget, the highest in Philippine history, includes 50 billion pesos for the special risk allowance of medical frontliners and 48 billion pesos for COVID-19 booster shots. The budget also includes 4 billion pesos for Typhoon Odette recovery efforts. The Philippine government's debt inched slightly lower in November to 11.9 trillion pesos. That's a 0.3% decrease from October's 11.97 trillion pesos as government paid some domestic liabilities. Favorable foreign exchange rates also pushing down the value of government borrowings. Since the start of this year, the Philippines has added nearly 2.14 trillion pesos to its debt as it borrows heavily to finance its pandemic response and government's infrastructure program. But economic managers have said the country's debt to GDP ratio remains sustainable despite the uptick in borrowing. The Philippine Central Bank expects December inflation to fall between 3.5% and 4.3% range. It says higher electricity rates and an uptick in food prices are the major sources of inflationary pressures for the month. But it notes these could be partially offset by oil price rollbacks and the appreciation of the peso. Philippine inflation eased to a four-month low of 4.2% in November, but still above government's target range of 2 to 4%. The BSP earlier said it would maintain its target inflation rate of 2 to 4% until 2024. The Philippine Central Bank issues a moratorium on fees imposed for InstaPay and PesoNet online fund transfers. Banks and e-money issuers cannot charge more until the BSP issues new pricing guidelines or once the volume of digital payments reaches 40%. The BSP says maintaining fund transfer fees at the current level is expected to boost the country's post-pandemic recovery. It adds the moratorium will also sustain the momentum achieved in increasing digital payments. Several banks have waived online fund transfer fees during the early months of the pandemic, with others extending this until the end of the year. But majority of financial institutions have been collecting fees again. The Philippine Environment Department allays concerns as the country lifts its ban on open-pit mining. The DENR says companies will be required to rehabilitate areas that have already been mined. The agency has also issued a blanket warning that it will shut down companies that will not comply with the rules.
Pag nahuli natin sila na they're not complying strictly with our policy, environmental laws, and sa mga bago nating policy sa mining, so talagang hindi tayo mangingimi na pasarado natin yan. Yan ang in-emphasize ng ating kalihim dyan.
The late DENR Chief Gina Lopez enforced the ban on open-pit mining back in 2017, citing its potential for causing disasters. But with the COVID-19 pandemic shattering the Philippine economy, the Mines and Geosciences Bureau says open-pit mining could boost state revenues. So as we've been reporting, the Philippines has lifted a 4-year-old ban on open-pit mining. That is the second landmark policy move by the Duterte administration to revitalize the industry and help drive economic recovery. The first one being lifting the moratorium on new mining permits. Joining us this morning to unpack this latest development is Rocky Dimakulangan, the Vice President for Communications at the Chamber of Mines of the Philippines. Rocky, good morning. Thank you so much for joining us.
Yes, good morning, Mimi. Happy to be here.
All right. So, Rocky, let's unpack open-pit mining. For those who are not familiar, it's essentially open-cast mining, meaning you dig or drill or blast the surface to get the minerals which are close to the ground or surface. Is this recommended specifically for specific types of minerals, specific locations or topographies or budget?
Okay, glad you asked that. Open pit mining is a surface mining technique that extracts minerals from an open pit in the ground as opposed to underground mining. There are economic, safety, and environmental considerations for employing this method. Where underground mining cannot be applied, the open pit method is primarily employed, although there are other forms of surface mining. The shape, nature, and location of the ore body determine the mining method.
And Rocky, what are the specific shapes, size, locations that will say, okay, this is more suited for open pit mining?
Let's do an analogy here. No? Let's say you have a spaghetti with meatballs, and you have the meatballs on top, right?
Mm-hmm.
If the ore body is near the surface, in this case, the meatballs are on top. How do you get the meatballs? You use the fork to get it on top, right?
Mm-hmm.
You don't dig a tunnel underneath to get to the meatballs underneath.
Mm.
So that explains it.
Are there certain minerals that are more suitable for open pit mining?
Most copper gold projects are employ open pit mining. Nickel is near surface. That's why it follows surface mining, or it follows the contour of the land. I think the deepest that nickel goes is around 15 meters. So just following the contour of the land. With the open pit, you really have to get it from the top, and over time you get to the, because the ore bodies are shaped like roots of trees.
Okay.
These are formed over millions of years. And so you have to get to those roots from the top, because most of them are near the top. But if the ore body, which is determined through exploration over many years, is found to be really, you know, several hundred meters from the surface, you have to use underground mining.
Because Rocky, currently all of our mining operations are done through underground mining, right? Or also called the shaft mining, I understand, which also carries the risk of caving in or having toxic gas.
Those are attendant risks to mining. Both methods have attendant risks. At the moment, I understand there are three operating open pit mines. These were mines that were already operating when the ban was imposed, so they were not covered by the ban. Mm-hmm. These are the DPO mine in Nueva Vizcaya. Another is the Masbate Gold Project. And the other one is in Carmen Copper in Toledo City, Cebu.
Rocky, you know, the government is estimating that the latest moves to lift the moratorium on new mining permits, to finally allow open pit mining, will boost annual export revenue from the industry from mining to go up by some $2 billion over the next 5 to 6 years. Mm-hmm. As new mining projects take off, is this more or less accurate? Is this estimate more or less in line with your own projections? And if you could give us a rundown of the projects that are stuck in the pipeline, that have been stuck there for years, that could finally go ahead because of the latest move.
Okay, not all mining firms are members of the Chamber of Mines. No? Mm-hmm. Some of the biggest ones are part of our group. So we can only talk about our own estimates.
Okay.
Three projects alone, Silangan, Tampakan, and Kingking, these are copper gold mines and all are Mindanao, are expected to bring in a total of nearly $5 billion total capital investments over several years. Now, collectively, they can increase yearly national government revenues by 12 billion pesos a year. LGUs stand to benefit 1.5 billion annually, exports by $2 billion, and social expenditures by close to 800 million per year. You know, we are, by the way, the only one of the very few mining countries that prescribes for mandated social expenditures as a percentage of our operating costs, in consultation, of course, with host communities. You can imagine what yearly expenditures of almost 800 million per year can do to the development of those far-flung, yet highly mineralized areas that don't see development at all. Also, royalties to indigenous tribes of a little over 600 million a year, pesos. It is no wonder that IPs in such areas have been clamoring for the start of development of these projects. Mm-hmm. Also, the mining's GDP contribution for just these three projects alone will increase from the current 0.6 to 1.5%.
Wow, that's a lot of contribution. But you've got, on the other hand, the environmentalists. They won't have this. They say, you know, this cheap mining method is dangerous and it's destructive to life and planet. What do you say to critics like that? And if you could cite maybe global best practices to prove your point that we can actually do this properly, and if done properly, it will work, it can work.
Sure. You know, open pit mines can be operated safely according to globally accepted standards and can be rehabilitated properly in a manner that provides alternative and productive land use after the life of the mine. The choice of which method, as I mentioned earlier, to use has more to do with the shape, nature, and location of the ore body, and not because it is cheap. If I can I ask to show?
We do have a graphic. We do have the slides. I think we can show those slides.
Yes.
Okay, but go ahead. We'll just follow your lead.
Okay, first one you see here. Hold on. Is the Rum Jungle uranium mine in Australia?
Okay, we'll try to follow. Go ahead.
There. Can you see the graphic? Can you see the graphic now?
Yes, we can.
Okay. If to your left is the mine during the height of its operations, and to your right you can see the mine after rehabilitation. This one example is in Australia. Let's move to the next slide, please.
Okay, next slide from the studio. Which slide? Which one?
The next one, the Misima Gold Mine.
Misima Gold Mine. Okay, let's. But go ahead. You can start talking about it. We'll just follow.
Again, to your left is a mine during the height of operations, and to the left, to the right, you can see the rehabilitated mine.
Okay.
And then this one is Waitakere Valley in New Zealand. Same. And back home, to your left is the Philex Sebutad of gold operations in the early 90s. And to the right, you can see it fully rehabilitated. And the next one is the TVI Kanatuan project in Zamboanga del Norte. I was part of this project before it closed in 2015. So here you can see to your right, the trees that were planted there are beginning to grow. This is much better now. The picture, this is an old picture. Mm-hmm. Okay. Now, mandated mine rehabilitation is a feature of the 1995 Mining Act. You can go to the next slide, the Hinatuan Nickel Mine. Now, nickel mines in particular practice progressive rehabilitation since mining is generally done in parcels and as a parcel is mined out.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And the next one, Taganito Nickel Mine in Surigao del Norte. The next one, Cagdanao Nickel Mine in Dinagat Islands. Progressive rehabilitation going on here. And this is a sort of a 10-year challenge from May 2008 to the current one. This is one is in Ryutuba Nickel Mine in Palawan.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, I should point out that the footprints of the large-scale metallic industry today is only about 2% of the total land mass of our country. A doubling of operating mines would therefore not mean that there will be mines all over the place, affecting food security and so forth and so on, especially given the fact that there are so many no-go areas for mining in our country. Certainly, the environment in mining areas will be altered, but under our laws, those areas have to be restored. Mining is a temporary land use, mm-hmm. and the land can be restored. There are already enough examples of that in our country that I just pointed out. And you know, what has really affected the reputation of our country is the fact that there is a lot of illegal mining taking place in certain parts of our country with no environmental measures whatsoever. Mm-hmm. People don't generally differentiate between large-scale responsible mining and destructive illegal mining. In their minds, it is all mining. Also, as you mentioned earlier, under the former DNR secretary, the industry took a big hit when mine audits that were conducted led to much published closure orders to about 26 mining operations, more than half of which are operating metallic mines. You can imagine the impact of that from a public perception point of view.
Mm-hmm.
Those mines appealed such order and were allowed to continue operating while on appeal. And since then, the Mining Industry Coordinating Council, or MICC, which is chaired by both the DNR and the Department of Finance, decided to conduct new audits on those mines that were served with closure orders to get to the bottom of this issue. Why were so many metallic mines served with closure orders? A team was composed of academics, technical people, social scientists, and the like. In other words, a multidisciplinary group composed of experts in their respective fields. And the audits took place a couple of years ago. The outcome was that only three of those 26 mines had enough serious lapses to warrant their permanent closure. And those mines were already not operating. Everyone else passed, although some were directed to undertake some remedial measures. Certainly, the new audits gave a very different picture to what was presented to the public after the first audit under the former secretary.
Rocky, thank you for running through, you know, some of the best practices to prove that, yes, you can do it properly. It has been done as long as mining companies rehabilitate the area after using it. Because as you mentioned, mining is a temporary land use.
Mm-hmm.
But for the environmentalists, they look back to some major tragedies and say there were also times it didn't work. There were times the miners were irresponsible. Talk about the Mar copper mining disaster of 1996. Not just in the Philippines, you've also got open pit mining that actually caused tragedies in countries like Myanmar, for example, very recently, or other Southeast Asian countries. What do you say to that? You can't blame the environmentalists for being worried, especially just look, you know, Mindanao, for example, where a lot of these mine sites are located. Without the open pit mine, a lot of these areas are already vulnerable to flooding, to typhoons. And add mining to the mix, it complicates the picture, doesn't it?
Okay, let me tackle that Mar copper disaster first. It happened in 1996.
Mm-hmm.
You will recall that the Philippine Mining Act was enacted in 1995. The laws that governed the Mar copper mine were so much different then. Today, you know, you have to do progressive mine rehabilitation. You have to have a final mine rehabilitation and development plan or program,
mm-hmm.
even before you start operating, and you have to put up a fund to make sure that if something unfortunate happens, you have a fund to draw from. Now, while the 1995 Mining Act became a law in 1995, its constitutionality was questioned in court. And the Supreme Court ruled with finality of its constitutionality only in 2004. So essentially, we have a very, a relatively new mining law.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
But the ones that are operating now are doing so under very, one of the best mining laws in the world, if not the best. We have what we call the Social Development and Management Program, as I mentioned earlier, part of our operating costs. We have the final mine rehabilitation and development program.
Okay.
We do free prior informed consent from our, if the mining site has indigenous peoples in it. During the debate, it's discussed with the members of the host community.
Mm-hmm.
If there are IPs, we help them formulate the ancestral domain sustainable development plan. So we have to contend with an alphabet soup of laws. And I must say that the laws are adequate.
Okay.
What I want to emphasize here is that everybody agrees that mining is an essential industry. We cannot do this interview without mining. I mean, the camera that we use, the teleprompter that you're using, everything needs mining. In fact, climate change will require power generation technologies and, batteries so that we will minimize our emissions to the carbon emissions. This will require mining. Now, let's do an analogy again. Let's say an airplane crashes. It's from the aviation. Do we close the entire aviation industry? No, because it is an essential industry. Yeah. What I'm trying to point out is that we penalize those that are negligent of their obligations, but do not close the entire industry, because we are a poor man sitting in a pot of gold. No? Our country badly needs the resources. And one of the misconceptions about mining is that you only harness the natural resources, the natural assets. But with mining, with responsible mining, you get access to funds that will also enable you to harness your human assets. You send the poor deserving students to school. Mm-hmm.
We don't have much time, but it's a nice point that you're saying. We're like a poor man sitting on a pot of gold. We cannot close down the whole industry because of some bad players. And certainly the industry is not closing. In fact, it's been a very good year for the industry because of these policy developments. So let's take a look at 2022. What is the outlook for the industry next year? Let's start with the top mineral exports of the Philippines. You've got copper, gold, and nickel. Well, you've got for the non-metallic mine operations, you've got Semirara, of course, accounting for what? Almost 97% of coal production. Give us the outlook for supply, for demand, and pricing for these things that we mine very quickly for next year.
Okay, we see nickel and gold prices to sustain their performance, and we hope that copper and other metals to follow soon. We see opportunities will continue to outweigh risks in 2022 as governments around the world invest in stimulus activities to revive economies battered by the pandemic, and as the drive to transition to clean energy alternatives accelerates. Now, a recent global survey conducted by Ernst & Young among miners indicates that external influences such as environmental and social issues, decarbonization, license to operate, and uncertain demand will keep driving risks and opportunities as stakeholder and capital market pressure continues to hold miners accountable.
Mm-hmm.
Miners that are able to demonstrate their contribution to a sustainable future will be able to access the rapidly growing pool of capital available for strong environmental, social, and governance performers.
All right. Final question, Rocky. Let's set our sights to the future. Mm. How does the future of mining look like? I mean, you've got advanced economies now talking about space mining.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Miners will increasingly have to contend with issues with a much larger economic, social, environmental, and technological ecosystem. They will have to deal with more and more with some of the key disruptive forces emerging today and the impact they might have on mining in the future. For instance, the need to address climate change, as I mentioned earlier, mm-hmm. will provide the industry a tremendous opportunity to participate in the worldwide trend towards mineral-intensive power generation and battery storage technologies. Meanwhile, manufacturers, financial institutions, and investors are increasingly leaning towards dealing only with suppliers of metals that have consistently excellent ESG performance records. Mining operators have to start shaping up, or they will find themselves shipping out. As to mining in space, I watched a documentary where scientists are beginning to design spaceships that they hope can one day mine on asteroids and even other planets. In fact, that was a part of the film Don't Look Up that I watched on Netflix only last week.
By the way, which is now the highest grossing film on Netflix. But go ahead. Space mining. Go ahead.
With the quantum leaps in science and technology, I'm sure mining in space won't be too far off. It could happen within this decade or the next.
Okay. And, back in October, I remember there was a Forbes story that said scientists have discovered two asteroids close to the Earth that we can mine, and the precious metals in those two asteroids could actually exceed Earth's global reserves. Exciting times ahead.
Yes.
On that note, Rocky, thank you so much for joining us and for clarifying some issues regarding these policy changes. We look forward to doing more interviews next year, because certainly mining is the sector to watch for 2022. Thank you for joining us and Happy New Year.
Thanks for having me. Happy New Year.
All right. Now, here are some economic data releases we're monitoring today. Thursday, Spain will post its December inflation print. Spain's consumer price index rose 5.5% in November, the highest inflation rate since September of 1992, on the back of a strong recovery in demand and a surge in energy costs. And the U.S. will report its initial jobless claims numbers. The number of Americans applying for unemployment benefits came in at 205,000 in the week ended December 18th, in line with market expectations. Up next, to look at how Asian markets are doing this morning with Swarup Gupta of the Economist Intelligence Unit. This and more when Market Edge returns.
Mobility will be key to recovery, because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods now, and we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
the greatest disruptor of all time is actually COVID-19 because of limited mobility. People are also not being able to go to physical branches, etc. So it further accelerated the adoption of consumers of digital channels. We are now being able to provide the services needed by our citizens, by our consumers.
Market Edge, the headlines, the Dow and the S&P 500 notching new record highs as Wall Street shrugs off fears about the Omicron variant, Asian shares opening mixed. Here at home, the PSE Index takes a breather for the result day holiday after climbing back above 7,300 yesterday. Swarup Gupta of the Economist Intelligence Unit joins us later for the show for an outlook on Asian markets. And you've got President Rodrigo Duterte set to sign the 5 trillion peso 2022 national budget today. And the Philippine government says rules are in place to ensure the protection of the environment as it lifts the ban on open pit mining. Rocky Dimaculangan of the Chamber of Mines of the Philippines also asserting open pit mines can be operated safely and can be rehabilitated properly. He adds you cannot close down the industry for the fault of a few players. It would be like being a poor man sitting on a pot of gold if we do not unlock the value of the minerals in the Philippines. Asian markets are trading mixed this morning, failing to get a boost from a record session on Wall Street overnight as investors continue to assess the implications of the fast-spreading Omicron variant, decreasing stimulus and elevated inflation. As you can see, Japan's Nikkei 225 leading shares in the region lower, while Australia's ASX 200 is managing to book modest gains. Here at home, the PSE is closed today for result day holiday. The main index, however, did rise for a third straight day on Wednesday, closing back above 7,300 level. Joining us now for his take on the market, Swarup Gupta of the Economist Intelligence Unit. Swarup, good morning. Happy holidays. Thank you for joining us.
Morning, Michelle. Happy holidays to you and everyone watching the show. And thank you for having me.
Thank you for joining us. So, Swarup, what are your expectations for equity returns, given what we're seeing now from central banks and how steeply Omicron cases are rising? I mean, the U.S. posting its single largest spike, over 500,000 new infections in one day. Is it time to temper the optimism in the markets and perhaps take a more bearish view for 2022?
Yes. So we have done some research at Economist Intelligence Unit on Omicron, and we still believe that the core scenario, our core scenario, is that it's far more infectious than Delta, but it's milder. Current vaccines will probably prevent severe infections, but we are seeing that vaccines aren't preventing infections completely, which means that they don't insulate you against the infection, but they do inhibit the severity of infections. Mm-hmm. And in that sense, there is a smaller likelihood that this particular variant will cause a large number of deaths and a huge wave of hospitalization and overwhelming of hospital systems, at least at this point. But as the WHO's head and other senior global bureaucrats have been saying, it's still early days. But at this point, what is probably likely to happen is a smaller wave of lockdowns and restrictions across the world, especially those parts of the developing world which are yet to vaccinate large parts of their population, and also parts of the developed world which see, severe increase in, or rather decrease in temperatures during winter. So we are seeing cases go up to a great extent in the United States and, the United Kingdom. At the same time, the Prime Minister of the United Kingdom has come out and said that, most people suffering more from the Omicron variant are those that haven't had booster shots yet. Mm-hmm. So it's a combination of factors, and it's got a lot to do with the extent of vaccination.
Given this, what we know and what we don't know yet about the virus, about this variant, what are you expecting from the markets when it comes to equity returns?
So it's going to be a little difficult to match up to the equity returns of 2021, that's pretty sure. So we're probably going to see a bit of flatness in the first half of 2022, and there's going to be a significant spike in volatility. The reason is that Omicron is emerging in different economies at different points in time. So that's the key point with the mutations or variations of this virus, that it doesn't emerge at the same pace at every single economy at the same time. So there is some sustained volatility in the system. And at the same time, they're going to be, because of this volatility, there some stocks are going to gain quite excessively, while there are going to be some significant losers. Mm-hmm. So that's going to continue, at least for this variant, and perhaps for a few more variants that happen during 2022. So as soon as the variant emerges, there's going to be a significant level of volatility, which leads to outsized gains for some stocks and outsized losses for some other stocks.
Mm-hmm. And how do you categorize which stocks are going to see outsized gains and outsized losses? Which ones?
So that's a little difficult to call at this point, but one thing is for sure, that those stocks which made the most of the pandemic and some of the systemic changes that it brought will probably not be able to replicate their success. So Zoom is one example, which is what we are also using at this point, which the share price made outsized gains during the pandemic, if you've been tracking that particular story. But since then, those gains have tapered off. So unless you have a fundamental basis to your business, and unless your business proposition is massively strong, then some of the outsized gains that you made during the early days of the pandemic, or even during mid-2021, are going to quickly disappear. Whereas, stocks which have a basis in longer-term trends, for example, environmental, social, and governance issues, are the ones that are probably going to be important, as well as those which gain from the investments in public digital infrastructure which are happening across emerging Asia, including the Philippines.
Speaking of the Philippines, Swaroop, I'm very curious, what's your call on the Philippine stock market? Are you overweight, underweight, or neutral on Philippine equities, and why?
So ultimately, the stock market or the equity market performance depends to a great extent on the wider economy. At the same time, we are seeing a divergence between economic performance and stock market returns, and that divergence is probably likely to continue for a while. The Philippines itself is still beginning to emerge from the impacts of the virus, but at the same time, economic performance will continue to improve as larger parts of the population get vaccinated, and then ultimately perhaps even booster doses are rolled out. But it's going to be a little difficult for the Philippines to recover to pre-COVID economic performance for a while. So that's not going to provide the kind of solid basis for stock market returns that is necessary for longer term gains. At the same time, those stocks and those sectors, which, as I've said, gain from investments in public digital infrastructure, such as the Philippines national ID system, cryptocurrency, which enables faster and easier payments, as well as investments in infrastructure and environmental, social, and governance norms. So I was listening in very keenly to your earlier discussion, mining, for instance. Those stocks have a firmer basis for gains over more than one, market or calendar year.
Okay. Aside from the Philippines, Swaroop, I hope we could go over the list of other markets in the region. Maybe you could give us a quick snapshot of how you assess the investment environment there and the prospects for next year, the outlook, for example. Let's start with China. We know that China is still facing problems from the property sector, piling costs for its zero COVID strategy, slowing exports and factory closures because of fresh wave of infections. How are you viewing the Chinese market?
So the Chinese market, so at this point, it's not just the wave of infections, but government's reaction to infections, mm-hmm. which is probably dictating, the movement of markets as well as the trajectory of economies. So as China continues to follow a zero COVID policy, which means that there's completely no tolerance. It will not allow movement. As soon as it sees that COVID cases have grown to an outsized degree, it locks down and issues containment restrictions, and it's doing that at this moment. At the same time, it's not an uninvestable environment. I think at this point, investors have priced in the kind of regulatory actions that we are likely to see because of China's Common Prosperity Program. So at the same time, valuations have dipped quite a little, which makes this a very interesting entry point to some of the sectors and some of the industries which are likely to gain as a result of Common Prosperity. However, investors will have to be a little careful while assessing which sectors they get into. So, for example, online education has taken a massive hit because of the Common Prosperity agenda. The other sector that's taken a massive hit is digital health applications because of the new norms affecting telehealth. So it's quite likely that those sectors which are more of a social purpose, particularly, for example, in this case, healthcare and education, are ones that investors would want to closely look at and assess companies on a case-by-case basis before moving in.
All right. From China, let's move to Japan, where some of the big brokerage houses, investment banks are saying cheap valuations plus low exposure could bring in more foreign funds into the Japanese market. Are you liking Japan at this point?
On a lighter note, one could argue that many economies will undergo what's called Japanification over time, which means, more of an aging population and higher interest rates. And I think over the longer term, we're going to learn that Japan did not mismanage its economy for the longest while and did well. Of course, there are many things that probably could have been done better. For example, have an easier immigration policy or allow more women into the workforce, but I'm digressing. At this point, I'd like to say that it's become a little difficult to guarantee the kind of fixed income returns that have been happening for a while. So you see, even Japanese pension funds get into the private equity, space to try and justify those returns. One thing we have to look at when one looks at cost of capital, particularly in Japan and low valuations, is that because of environmental, social, and governance issues, the cost of capital is likely to rise significantly. Mm-hmm. Huge amount of funds will be required to undertake the mining, undertake the energy transition that is necessary to address some of the issues that were raised at COP26 earlier this year. So while at this point, in the short and medium term, yes, Japan also looks like an attractive entry point, it's important to keep in mind that the cost of capital is likely to rise substantially. And one of the reasons for that is COVID. During COVID, people have seen the impact on environment. Mm-hmm. There's been a renewed focus on those issues that is likely to play out over 2022 as well.
All right. From Japan, let's go to Vietnam, a darling of investors, but not as of late, because they are taking the last spot of the Philippines as the worst place to be in during COVID in the latest COVID resiliency ranking of Bloomberg. Their GDP growth also falling to a new 30-year low. How are you viewing Vietnam?
So again, when it comes to Vietnam, what is interesting is how they're making investments in public digital infrastructure. Those are the investments that are going to land them in good stead, and most important investments, critical investments to improve financial inclusion, improve market size and the potential of economies are those in payment systems. Many of these payment systems are leveraging blockchain technology. Many of the countries are moving towards research on central bank digital currencies. And while at this point, probably Vietnam isn't looking as attractive as, say, China continues to look at, you must understand that valuations remain quite interesting. Again, I would say that investors would like to assess particular sectors. So, for example, IT services, yeah, infrastructure, surgicals and pharmaceuticals, and even banking. So that's the other sector that's probably going to look much better in 2022, because the significant amount of bad loans is going to become more and more apparent across the region. But as economies rebound from COVID, which is quite likely in the second half of 2022, and it's discovered that they've been far more resilient, banking and financial services are going to do well across Southeast Asia for sure.
Okay. And what about Australia? Surprising that the Aussies became richer faster than ever before in 2021, with household wealth up by a whopping 20% over the last 12 months. And that's despite the pandemic and the recession. Household net wealth rose to its highest ever level this year.
Yes, I think the Australian economy has a lot to gain from the mining push that is going to continue because of these ESG issues that we spoke about. Some analysts and some observers are already saying that these new minerals, which are, you know, lithium, for example, or cobalt or nickel, which are going to be used to create electric vehicle batteries and the other materials needed for the energy transition, are absolutely crucial. Some are even going as far as calling them the new oil, because as the reliance on oil goes down and the reliance on these minerals go up, searching for these minerals, finding new geospatial methods to detect these minerals and then extract these minerals in a socially and environmentally conscious manner is going to be crucial. And as we all know, the Australian economy depends in an outsized manner on mining and materials resources. So it's quite likely that minerals and materials rich economies are going to, you know, come into renewed focus over 2022 and even beyond. So it's quite likely that a lot of this household wealth increase that you're talking about, not all of it will be sustained, but there is a firm basis for sustaining some of this in the longer term.
Mm-hmm. And Swarup, you mentioned this earlier, you talked about tech and IT, because in South Korea, six of the 10 best performing stocks this year are actually linked to the metaverse, the virtual universe, including non-fungible tokens, including WeMade Max company, which has surged 1,500%. Exciting, exciting times to be in the market these days. Swarup, thank you so much for taking us. Here's a quick rundown of some corporate stories here at home. AC Energy investing a total of 14 billion pesos in two RE projects. That's 7 billion for the Biog Wind Power Corporation and another 7 billion for Santa Cruz Solar Energy. This is going to help the company, the energy arm of the Ayala Group, to hit its target of hitting 5,000 megawatts of RE capacity by 2025. And you've got Okada Manila International, the operator of one of the big integrated resort casinos in Entertainment City. They're going to be listing on the NASDAQ in the U.S. That's right, via a special purpose acquisition, a merger with 26 Capital. U.S. President Joe Biden plans to speak by phone with his Russian counterpart, Vladimir Putin, on Thursday. This amid an alarming Russian military buildup on its shared border with Ukraine. Washington and its European allies have repeatedly warned Moscow invading Ukraine will trigger economic and political countermeasures. The spokesperson of the U.S. National Security Council says the two leaders will discuss a range of topics, including upcoming diplomatic engagements. Next month, U.S. and Russian officials will also hold security talks focusing on arms control agreements, NATO, and Russian military activity. Time to zip through the top headlines from major business papers from Business World. Third quarter residential property prices jumping by its fastest pace since the second quarter of 2020 due to an uptick in demand for condominium units and townhouses. From Business Mirror, the Philippine government's foregone revenues from reducing tariffs on pork imports reaching 3.6 billion pesos as of middle of December. And from the Wall Street Journal, U.S. Airlines continuing to struggle as unusually strong jet stream winds take a toll on transcontinental flights. In other news, 9 out of 10 adult Filipinos are entering the new year with hope. That's according to a survey conducted by the social weather stations from December 12 to 16 this year. 93% of the 1,440 respondents said they're entering 2022 with hope rather than with fear. Compared to the end of last year, hope for the coming year rose in Metro Manila from 90 to 95%, Balance Luzon from 92 to 93%, and the Visayas from 88 to 90%. It stayed at 93% over in Mindanao. And before we go, preparations are in full swing in New York City for the annual New Year's Eve ball drop in Times Square. The crystal ball was upgraded with a new design dubbed the Gift of Wisdom. For the second year in a row, the New Year's Eve countdown in Times Square will be a scaled-back event due to the pandemic. The attendees will be capped at 15,000 as New York City battles a surge in cases driven by the Omicron variant. But organizers say the tradition will remain despite the inescapable shadow of the pandemic.
This year, the mayor and everyone have announced that we're going to have reduced revelers in Times Square, but we're going to have more than a billion revelers around the world joining us on TV and on the internet celebrating. It's the one moment where we all come together, even if it's just for 60 seconds, as we count down towards 2022.
Aside from upgrading the crystal ball, organizers also did a test run of the confetti drop, much to the delight of tourists and New Yorkers in Times Square. And that is it for the show. I'm Michelle Long. Thank you so much for watching. You can listen to our interviews again on the ANC Market Edge podcast, available on Spotify. You can also watch highlights, recaps, exclusive content, or shows online. Subscribe to the ANC YouTube channel, like us on Facebook, and follow us on Twitter. Stay safe and stay with ANC.
Mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods now, and we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.